The centre of the continent, from the capital of Zaire, Kinshasa, where it's estimated that more than 50 people are dying from the disease every week, Julian Mannion begins this report on AIDS in Africa.
In the slums of Mobutu's capital, Kinshasa, AIDS is a new cause of despair. More than 3 million people live in poverty, with malaria and typhoid as known killers. Now AIDS is spreading as a mainly sexually transmitted disease, affecting both men and women equally. It took less than 24 hours for President Mobutu's Secret Service to hear that we had filmed this interview. Their response was to arrest us. A Secret Service officer told us that it is forbidden to take pictures in the slum known as La Cité, forbidden to film the AIDS crisis now taking root there. We were ordered to leave and put on a plane for Geneva. We were told that the order to throw us out was given by President Mobutu himself, and it was an action that dramatically highlighted the unique combination of medical and political problems that the World Health Organization now faces as it sets out to try and fight the AIDS epidemic in Africa. For many of the countries worst affected by the disease are totally unprepared for the battle against it. Political crises, poverty, mismanagement, and downright corruption have left many African health services in a state of virtual collapse. And nowhere is that more true than in Zaire. Before we were expelled, we managed to film inside a hospital, which was once regarded as one of the most modern in Africa, the University Clinic of Kinshasa. Today, the health service budget for a country of 30 million people is just £2.5 million a year, less than it costs to run one major hospital in Britain. Mothers still bring their children for treatment and are torn by grief when their loved ones die. But in this hospital, medicines are only available for those who can pay. Facilities range from inadequate to dangerous. The blood bank is a refrigerator dating from the 1950s. The shelves are dirty, and there is still no equipment to screen the blood and protect the patients who receive it. It's estimated that 10% of the blood bank is now contaminated with the AIDS virus.
Dans les pays en voie de développement, le problème de moyens est un problème aigu, sur aigu.
In developing countries, resources are a problem, a very severe problem. Take syringes and needles, for example. Here, we simply cannot afford to only use syringes and needles once. That would become terribly expensive. And no hospital here, no government even, has enough resources to regularly equip a hospital with these things without supplies breaking down.
To treat major accidents or diseases like malaria, blood transfusions are still needed. But the idea of using the blood bank literally gives some doctors nightmares.
It's a real problem. When we know someone is going to have a blood transfusion, we are always afraid, really worried. We don't know if we're going to give that patient AIDS or not, because we have had people here who have got AIDS through blood transfusion, even children and pregnant women. So it is a very, very serious decision with potentially disastrous consequences. Now the policy is that doctors must only give transfusion when it is really necessary, only when there's a really good reason for it.
So scarce are resources. The patients must supply their own linen, with laundry being done by relatives outside. Hospital staff are paid starvation wages. Nurses often charge patients to make their beds. According to a Belgian doctor, poverty often leads to the theft of hospital supplies.
They've got practically nothing. And if somehow a hospital gets equipped, things get worse again very quickly. The staff steal things, either for their own use or to resell elsewhere. And after a few months, there's nothing left. They never take precautions now. There's no control, no inventories. Have you ever seen an inventory here? Nothing. So everyone helps themselves. Workers come and they leave with souvenirs. Because they don't steal anything, they take souvenirs.
The The windows of the AIDS wards are painted green because there are no proper curtains. In Zaire, the risks of contamination are so real that doctors like Professor Laruma are advising patients to stay at home if at all possible. The hospital itself can be a danger zone.
Pour mes propres malades, je ne les admets à l'hôpital que vraiment si c'est strictement nécessaire.
With my own patients, I only admit them to hospital when it's absolutely necessary. For example, if someone is very dehydrated, you can't rehydrate them at home, so you have to take them into hospital to treat them. But apart from that, I try as far as possible to leave them at home, treating them as outpatients. Not only because of the lack of hospital resources, but also because it's a form of prevention. Because the more they're at home, the more they're out of the way of needles, injections, blood, and all those things. So that's a method of prevention, by keeping them at home as much as possible where they're not in contact with the equipment we use.
At another hospital, researchers are now working on a vital question. How far has the AIDS epidemic in Kinshasa really spread? A team backed with American money is testing the blood of different groups in the city's population of around 4 million. We've seen some of their results, and some from the separate French-backed team. What's starting to emerge is a unique and disturbing picture of the spread of the AIDS virus in an African city. Pregnant women attending two of the city's hospitals are shown to be 5.7% seropositive. Staff at one of the main hospitals in the capital, 7.5% positive. Workers at the Utexco textile factory, 4%. Army soldiers at a barracks in Kinshasa, 12% seropositive. And in a sample of 107 young male students seeking to study in France, again 12%. Some experts now believe that around 8%, or 1 in 12, of the sexually active population of Kinshasa is infected with the AIDS virus. In the next 5 years, many of these will fall ill, placing a tremendous burden on the crumbling health service. Infection exists in all classes of society, and one fear is that deaths among the educated elite could damage the country's future. Another concern is the fate of the newborns doomed to die of the disease.
It's a little bit cruel, but children don't transmit this disease. They get it and they die. It's distressing, but it's probably not as important as when a young man at the age of 25 or 30 who's married and has two children, when he dies. There we're dealing with someone who has family responsibilities, someone who the state has invested in training. And I think the consequences of that are much more profound than childhood death.
One man who has had an insider's view of how Zaire's income is spent is West German banker Erwin Blumenthal. In the late 70s, he was sent to Kinshasa by the International Monetary Fund to try and restore order in the central bank of Zaire. The country was, and still is, heavily in debt to Western banks. Blumenthal returned home after two threats against his life.
If you ask me if I was surprised, that would really be underdoing it, because surprise is not the right word for European or an American. It's inimaginable what you found and what you see, and money going out, even in cash, let's say banknotes, dollars and so on, where there is nothing. You even don't get a receipt. The bank spends it, the president asks for it. The president asks the governor to come back and to fly to Badoli, to his villa there, to bring him cash money. That's something that's unimaginable for European.
How much control does Mobutu have over the wealth of Zaire? How much personal control?
You see, I wouldn't say how much control he has, because he is, in this respect, Mobutu is Zaire. He controls it all.
Today, as health conditions worsen in Kinshasa, Mobutu spends much of his time in his palace on the outskirts of Brussels. It's one of a string of lavish properties that he owns in Europe. and the US government estimates his personal fortune at $5 billion, making him one of the richest men in the world. It's an achievement for a man who came to power as a simple army officer. Today, his security guards are anxious to protect their leader from prying eyes, even in the streets of Belgium. But malnutrition in the streets of the capital bears witness to the difficulty of getting money through to where it really counts. Previous aid programs seem to have made little impact on the despair of Zaire. How then to fight this new, mysterious and deadly disease?
I would like to think that AIDS is different than childhood vaccination programs, diarrheal disease control programs, family planning programs. AIDS is a very powerful motivator for the reasons I told you. No one wants to die of this disease. There have been malaria control programs, trypanosomiasis control programs, but they haven't carried quite the same weight that AIDS does.
What you seem to be saying, even to the politicians of this country, is that whatever may have happened, whatever they may have done with the money that was supposed to come in aid for other programs, AIDS is too important. AIDS means life or death.
That's exactly what I'm saying. I think the fact that this disease cuts across all economic boundaries, many families have had a close member who has succumbed to this disease. It's an important public health problem here. It's something that has touched the lives of many people. And I think there is a huge public outcry to do something about this. And I think AIDS has now become, it has a political agenda as well. And I think we will see effective programs mounted.
Equipment given years ago by the World Health Organization is what Professor Laruma now uses to play his part in the French-backed effort to find a vaccine. Laruma is evidence that the fight against AIDS is worldwide. Some hope is now pinned on the projected vaccine tests, which he will help to organize. Vaccine trials among the population in Zaire could help to find an answer if the government gives the go-ahead. In 20 years, President Mobutu has given his people a national identity. Every day, market traders stand to attention for the national anthem. Now, in the AIDS crisis, he has the power to give them hope.
Julian Mannion on the hope and the despair about AIDS in Africa.